हेलो। हाँ
गुड आफ्टरनून सर, ललित कुमार सिंह सर,
या गुड आफ्टरनून।
वेलकम टू गीतम यूनिवर्सिटी फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम सर। हैप्पी
थैंक यू।
टू हैव यू हियर ऑन दिस प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर शेयरिंग नॉलेज ऑफ फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम इन द नेम ऑफ एआईसीटी अटल स्पॉन्सर्ड प्रोग्राम सर।
यस थैंक यू।
सर, वील वेट फॉर फ्यू मोर मिनट्स फॉर पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू ज्वाइन।
या
I'll let
श्योर।
you know. I'll let you know when people have joined, sir.
ओके या श्योर।
Thank you, sir. Lalit Kumar Singh. Sir, I'll be starting now. Hope participants reached around 44 something.
Okay. Okay, as
sir.
You wish.
Okay, sir. Let me have a brief introduction, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, one and all present to know here. This is Rajshekhar from the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Geetham School of Technology, Geetham Bangalore campus. Very good afternoon to you all. And I would like to extend a warm welcome to the today's panelists as well as the participants. It's a wishes from Geetham University Bangalore campus for all you are being presented over here for this 5-day faculty development program conducted by Geetham University Bangalore Mechanical Department under the sponsorship of AICT Atal program. Thank you. And it's a great honor for me to introduce today's session's speaker, Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh. So Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh has received his PhD degree from Indian Institute of Technology. So earlier it was renowned as a Banaras Hindu University. He's currently a scientist in NPCIL BARC, B-A-R-C, Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India. So since 17 years, and has a distinction of working on pressurized heavy water reactors and light water reactors. Dr. Lalit Singh has an illustrious career and succeeded in several critical jobs assigned to him in his illustrious career. Through each of them was challenging. So Dr. Lalit, his assignments over the years range from design, development, testing, 4 and 5 related research and site validation of the safety critical computer-based systems of Indian nuclear power plants. Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh has published several research papers in journals of high impact factor like IEEE Transactions, IEEE Computer, ACM Elsewhere, Quality and Reliability International, etc. He has also been invited for chief guest as a chief guest and keynote speeches, sessions chair and talks in many international conferences, short-term courses, workshops, and faculty development programs from many reputed institutions like IITs, NITs, and other institutes of national importance. Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh is a recipient of many awards like Publication Award, Group Achievement Award, etc. He is a reviewer of several SCA indexed journals of high impact factors. He is a life member of Indian Nuclear Society. Dr. Lalit Singh is a member of editorial board of many reputed journals and guest lead editor of many special issues. He is supervising many PhD students of different reputed institutions of India like IITs, NITs, and is PhD thesis examiner of IITs, NITs, and other reputed institutes. He is an expert member of industrial policy formation of IIT Ropar and BOS of many autonomous institutes and member on the advisory board of many institutes and universities. He is also a reviewer and project collaborator of research proposals of Board of Research in Nuclear Sciences, shortly named as BRNS. And he is also faculty of Nuclear Training Center, Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India. Dr. Lalit Singh is an interfacing with other countries like Russia, United States of America, France, etc. For importing nuclear reactors that are based on new technologies.
Oh, yes,
his research interests are in the area of reliability, safety, and security of safety critical computer-based systems. So far, he has completed 33 projects of Department of Atomic Energy related to the Government of India. So today we are very great and honored to have Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh as today's session speaker. And once again, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh on behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering, Geetham University. So I request Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh to please share the screen and he may go on with the PPT presentation. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Shekhar, for introduction. And also, I would like to thank the organizing committee to invite me to share some of the experience, industrial experience to the participants. And before I start with my session, I think Dr. Shekhar, you are recording this session, but only I'll be requesting not to share it in the public domain.
Because okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So let me share my screen. Are slides visible?
Yes, sir. It's visible, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So I'll be talking on research scope in nuclear energy, and which is a kind of green energy, because there is no pollution in this nuclear energy because of the working mechanism of the nuclear energy. Definitely we'll touch upon what will be the working mechanism of this nuclear energy, so that the participant can appreciate like how it will, it is a green energy. And then we will see like what all what are the research scope in this nuclear energy. And in the conclusion, I think the participants will be of various engineering domains or maybe of science domain also. So when I'll be discussing the research scope in nuclear energy, each and every participant or each and it will touch upon each and every domain, because this nuclear energy is a multidisciplinary area in which we make the use of almost all the basic sciences, applied sciences, and engineering sciences. So to start with, let us see what nuclear reactor is. So what happened in the nuclear reactor? The nuclear energy gets generated from the fission reaction. And there is a uranium nuclei, and uranium nuclei is a heavy nuclei. And we have already studied in from the high school onwards, or from 10th onwards, the atoms which contains heavy nuclei, basically that heavy nuclei breaks, and this breaking of heavy nuclei, auto breaking of heavy nuclei, is known as nuclear fission. And when this uranium nuclei break, it releases some of the radioactive byproducts, as well as in every reaction, almost 200 million electron volt of energy. And it also produces, each reaction also produces 2 to 3 neutrons. Now again, these 2 to 3 neutrons strikes with the uranium nucleus, and again it will, in every reaction, means suppose if one neutron is hitting uranium nuclei, it produces again two radioactive, some of the radioactive byproducts, as well as this 200 million electron volt of energy. And again, it will produce 2 to 3 neutrons. So in this way, the neutron population keeps on increasing, and every neutron keeps on hitting the uranium nuclei. And in this way, there is a large accumulation of energy, heat energy. And basically that heat energy has to be utilized to produce, for example, if I'm talking about a nuclear power plant, that heat, that huge amount of nuclear energy is used to drive the turbine, and which can produce the electric energy that can be connected to the grid, and it can to be reached to the consumers. So ultimately, this is a device which is designed to maintain this chain reaction, because this chain reaction keeps on increasing and the neutron population keeps on increasing exponentially, because as I have mentioned, in every reaction, 2 to 3 neutrons gets generated. And again, it will keep on multiplying, because each and every 2 to 3 neutrons again producing 2 to 3 neutrons. So there will be the exponential rise in neutron density. And that is the reason the power also rise exponentially. And to sustain this chain reaction, there should be some control mechanism which can control the neutron population. And basically this is the device which maintain, which does this kind of controlling. So it is a device to maintain this chain reaction, so that the steady flow of neutrons can be produced, which have been generated by the fission of this heavy nuclei. Or we can say like it is a kind of apparatus in which heat is produced due to nuclear fission chain reaction for generation of the electricity. Now next, let us see what are the various important components of the nuclear reactors. Although the nuclear reactors contain thousands, even lakhs of components, but I'll be specifically touching on some of the special components or important components of the nuclear reactor, based on which I'll be describing the working mechanism of the nuclear reactor. So if in this figure, you can see like the left portion is enveloped in a dome-shaped structure, which consists of basically two major, three major components. One in the if you see in the left hand side, there is a rectangular box. Basically, this rectangular box is known as calandria, or we can known as pressure vessel. And inside this, the nuclear reaction takes place. So what happens inside this, the uranium act as a fuel. And if you can see like these white colored strips are uranium fuel, which has been inserted in the form of bundles, and in between these white colored strips, if you are able to see, there are red colored strips, because as I said, we have to sustain the nuclear reaction. So there is a control rods basically, and these control rods are made of a material which can eat the excess neutrons, and hence it can sustainability of the chain reaction can be assured, because the neutron density, it can sustain the neutron density. So and these control rods are basically hanged from this mechanical clutch. This is a mechanical clutch, and it is hanged through a wire. And when there is more neutron density, that control rods are dropped from this mechanical clutch, and it can eat some of the neutrons. And when we want to increase the neutron density, we can remove these new control rods. So this mechanical clutch has a driven capability, which can drive these control rods in upward and downward direction. So this is known as the entire reactor core. And if you see, like, because a huge amount of heat energy gets generated in this reactor core, so that huge amount of heat energy has to be removed. So if you can see, there is a connected pipe which is basically going to a rectangular shaped, which has a dome type of a structure in its top. And this is known as a steam generator. Now this steam generator is, why, as the name is mentioned, it is responsible to generate the steam. And what is the working mechanism of this steam generator? How the steam gets generated? If you see, like, the steam generator contains two logical parts. the down the half of the almost half of the down lower part contains the normal water, and when this heat is transferred from the reactor core through this pipe, and in this pipe basically some coolant flows. Coolant means there could be some water or heavy water, whatever the refrigerant, depends on the type of the reactor. We'll be touching on what are the various type of the nuclear reactor as well. So depending on that, it contains some kind of coolant. It is a liquid coolant. So when this it is coming all the way from this reactor core, which is basically generating huge amount of heat energy. So that heat energy transfers to this coolant, and when it touches on the light water, which is already there in the lower portion of the steam generator, then suddenly it gets converted into the steam, because we know the boiling temperature of the water is 100 degree, and the temperature of this heat energy is almost 350 to 400 degree. So it can convert into the steam, and because steam has lighter density, it gets accumulated on the top like portion of this steam generator. And then first let me come to this loop. Then what then after exchanging the heat, then again it will become cool down. The water which was flowing, or the coolant which was flowing in this pipe, it gets cooled down, and it is again coming up, and there is a mechanical pump which can pump this water into this reactor core. And again, because this water is now cold water, and again it can the heat from the reactor core can be transferred into this water and or this coolant, and again it will keep on producing the steam. So this is the primary loop which can keep on working, and in this way, like it's a continuous loop, and in this way the steam keeps on generating. And now if you see this steam, basically it goes through some pipe, and which is connected to the steam turbine, which is basically driven by the steam. So the saturated, there are the two kind of steam. One is saturated steam and one is non-saturated steam. So the saturated steam will be useful to drive the steam turbine, and which can generate the electric, which can drive the electric generator to generate the electricity, and that electricity can be connected to the grid. Now the non-saturated steam again can be condensed, and there is a condenser. If you can see, there is a steam generator type of shaped, but here there's a water, and we know like when the steam touches to the cold surface, it gets condenses, and so there is a cold water which is coming through some external source. There is a pipe which so from here the cold water is coming, and the external source can be river, lake, or ocean. Or if you are installing this nuclear reactor where such kind of natural sources are not available, you can create an artificial source of cool water that is known as natural draft cooling water tower. So from there, the cooling water is coming all over, and it is pumping into this condenser, and in this way it can condense the steam which is coming and which has not been utilized to drive this electric generator. And so this is this again, after condensation, it is a pump which can pump in that water again to the steam generator, and in this way this is a secondary loop which can maintain the water level into the steam. And this is the tertiary loop, which is basically an external loop, which is just taking the cool water from the natural sources or artificial sources, and it helps to condense the this steam that is coming all the way from the steam turbine. And now this is the entire working mechanism of the nuclear reactor. If you can see, there are a lot of challenges, a lot of engineering challenges, basic science challenges are involved in this entire system. And that includes, suppose if we start with this mechanical clutch. Now, it should be very high reliable, and it can be operated by the electronic relays. So there are the electronic relays which can be energized or de-energized depending on like it want to release the control rod, or it want to grip the control rod, or move upward and downward direction. The designing of the mechanical clutch involves the mechanical engineering as well as the electronics engineering, and because it has to be operated by the software, so definitely the software plays an important role. And because it is a kind of embedded system, so definitely the embedded software design has to be come into the picture. Another challenge that involves in designing of these fuel bundles, and what should be the geometry of the fuel bundle to optimize the generation, to optimize the electricity generation process, as well as what should be the geometry of the control rods. And so all this has a major challenge about the nuclear physics as well as the mechanical person, because the nuclear physics has to tell like how many neutrons can be coming out, and total number of neutron population what will be there, and accordingly the control rod has to be designed so that it can be it can maintain the population of neutrons. And a huge challenge is involved in designing this calendria, because ultimately a lot of heat energy is created over here. So we have to design so such that with such a material, so that it cannot be more brittle also, because if your material will brittle, definitely it will have very less life. And in between, we cannot change this calendria throughout the lifetime of the nuclear reactor, because it contains so many radioactive elements. And we know like radioactive elements contains the half-life that ranges from milliseconds to billion of years. So definitely those we cannot touch upon. And that is the reason there is a huge challenge that is involved in designing this reactor vessel with respect to like the material, the selection of material, what kind of material has to be selected, or what kind of material has to be formed, and so that it will be able to sustain this so much of heat energy, as well as whatever the neutrons are produced, it should not be able to eat all the neutrons. It should be able to maintain this neutron density. So all these considerations needs to be taken by the physicist and by the mechanical engineer, so that like a balance phenomenon can be confronted. And then definitely like the designing of pumps, it plays a very important role. If you can see in this figure, although in the entire nuclear reactor there could be thousand and a thousand of pumps, but here if you see there are three pumps and each pump has although they are doing the same function, which is pumping the liquid into something, but definitely how much pressure has to be pumped in, and all those functional variables needs to be decided. That needs to be decided with respect to the phenomenon, and definitely here the mechanical engineers plays a very important role, like up to which pressure it has to pump in into the destination. So, and what should be the capacity of the pump, and this has to be like all these factors needs to be considered. Now, second one is because this pipe is of some material and the coolant is flowing 24 hours, and that has to be sustained for like 50 to 60 years almost, and hence there should be some mechanism which can control the pH value of this, of all the fluids that are circulating through the mechanical components, and hence the role of chemical engineer and chemistry person involves comes into the place. And now if you can see now these two components are very radioactive components, because this steam generator is very tightly coupled with the reactor core, so the possibility of the radioactivity in these two components are very high, and that is the reason it has to be embedded into a different concrete structure. So if you can see the envelope that is containing this reactor core and steam generator, this envelope is made of concrete shape, and how should be designed this envelope so that all the radioactivity element can be confined into this geometry, and it should not reach out to the normal public. Otherwise, the reactor radioactive element can be exposed to the public in the public domain, and hence the stream of civil engineering plays comes into the picture. Who has to design what kind of materials to be used for designing of this containment, as well as what should be the structure of that containment. With respect to the strength or with respect to the confinement of the radioactive elements that are generated inside this. And always, it contains a negative pressure so that all the outside things can come in, but no inside things can go out. And in this way, we can ensure all the radioactive elements cannot go out, cannot escape from this containment. So that has to be taken up with the civil engineers, about the designing and what material should be used. And then it is going to the electric generator. What should be the capacity of the electric generator, how it should be designed, the grades, what are the grid conditions and all. Then here the role of electrical engineer comes into place, and to maintain to automate the various processes, the electronics engineers and computer science engineers plays an important role. So these are I wanted to conclude, there is a role of every kind of engineers. So that was the working mechanism of nuclear reactor in CRISP. Now let us try to describe these components in detail so that the research scope can be easily understood. So if you see the like the pressure vessel or the tube, so which was a inside which all the reactions were taking place. So it is usually a robust steel vessel, and which contains the reactor core and the moderator. There is a moderator. Basically, what happens? Why? What is the role of moderator? Let me explain. Depending on the type of the reactor, the neutron speed or the neutron energy plays an important role. For example, if I'm talking with respect to pressurized heavy water reactor, where the thermal neutrons plays an important role, because neutrons get generated by fission reaction, those neutrons are fast neutrons because it contains a high amount of energy, and there should be some mechanism, and those, if that high neutron energy strikes to uranium, it will not be able to hit the nuclei because of its high energy, and that is the reason it is required to thermalize these neutrons. And so to thermalize these neutrons, there is some special, there should be some special mechanism which can reduce this energy of this neutron. It is a kind of liquid, or for example, the heavy water. Heavy water can thermalize the fast neutrons. So it acts as a moderator. So there is a moderator which basically flows in this pipe, and it also basically used to thermalize this neutrons, whatever the neutrons are generating, because after thermalizing, and that the probability of hitting the uranium nucleus is very high. And if the probability is very high, definitely we'll be able to generate the heat energy which can be used to generate the electric energy. Accordingly, the pressure tube or this reactor vessel has to be designed or has to be constructed. Or it contain now, depending on the type of the reactor, it can contain inside the series of tubes which can hold, and these series of tubes can hold the fuel bundles basically. Or there is a different kind of reactor, we are not putting in the form of bundles, the entire fuel can be kept. So it depends, like the geometry of pressure vessel will totally depend on the type of the reactor that we are dealing with. Now this reactor core, let us see what are the working mechanism of the reactor core, and what are the various research scopes that includes in designing the reactor core. So as we said, like these are the fuel rods. If you see like in the black colors which are showing, it is a fuel rod, and the control rods are a long rectangular bar, white colored long rectangular bar. I have shown the three control rods in this figure, and there could be as many as the number of control rod will depend on the capacity of your nuclear reactor. If your capacity of the nuclear reactor is much, the control rod has to be more, because it depends on the size of the pressure vessel. Pressure vessel size will increase as we want to increase the capacity of the nuclear reactor. So, and this is a fuel rods. Now this is a moderator, suppose, and this is going, I have shown only partial pipe. So in this, inside this, the moderator is flowing, and which is going through the steam to the steam generator. So it is taking the coolant, is taking to the heat. Steam generator is known as, also known as heat exchanger, because it is, it its function is basically to exchange the heat. And again, this is a, here I have not shown the steam generator, but again that coolant will go again inside this. And then if you see, there is, it is confined in a rectangular box, which is known as pressure vessel, as we have already seen, which is a steel, which is made of steel. And then after this, if you see, there is a outer boundary, which is known as a reactor. It is known as the reactor. And inside this, there are so many neutrons gets generated, and which can escape out of this reactor or out of this, you know, inside boundary, which is a pressure vessel boundary. So there should be some mechanism which can, otherwise we should not waste also our neutrons, because that neutrons are only source of heat energy. And that is that, therefore we apply some kind of reflector which can reflect. If any neutrons tries to escape from the pressure vessel, it can reflect back, so that the hitting probability of this neutron with this, with the nuclear, with the nucleus of uranium will be more. So the, what kind of reflector we have to make, what so that also a topic of the research, and a lot of research is going on, and the type of the reflectors with respect to the optimization, and what kind of moderator we should use. A lot of research that is also going on, what kind of, what for, of which material the control rod should be made. And this is the shielding, basically it is a shielding. And so this is basically the entire nuclear reactor, and it consists of fuel elements, control rods, and coolant and moderator. And it cores generally have the shape of right circular cylinders with almost diameter that can range from 0.5 meter to 15 meter, as I said, depending on the size of the reactor. But as and when the diameter gets increases, a lot of other challenges comes into the play, into our scope. So second one is a reflector that I have already talked about. So it is placed around the core to reflect back some of the neutrons that leak out from the core surface. So what kind of reflector has to be chosen? That is the topic of the research, and so that it can be may use in practice. Now fuel, for example, these are the fuel bundles, and uranium-235 is a fissile. So you generally, pellets of uranium oxide are arranged in the tubes in the form of fuel rods, and these fuel rods are grouped in the form of bundles, and each bundle has to be placed into the nuclear reactor. So these are now the control rods. So control rod, as I said, now this control rod is made up of that material which can eat up the neutrons, because I want to control the density of the neutron. So it is made of there are the two chemicals like cadmium and boron has a very good chemical property of eating of the neutrons. So it can be made of cadmium also, or it can be made of boron, but both have pros and cons, because we'll have to see with respect to the life also. As I said, this is a very radioactive zone, and there is no kind of, you know, replacement or something. So it is very difficult. And that is the reason we'll have to choose the material for sustainable and long life. And so it's basically The function of the control rod is to slow down the rate of the reaction to a controllable limit. Otherwise, the chain reaction will keep on increasing and it can convert into the nuclear bomb. And the raising and lowering the control rods, it allow all the nuclear operators to control the rate of the nuclear reaction. So there is a control rod drive, and which contains some of the electronic relays that can be energized or de-energized to control the movement of the control rods in upward or downward direction. So here, if you see like the designing of this pressure vessel imposes a challenge, because we have to make a outlet as well as inlet, and what diameter, and so it should be a very integrated circuit. There should not be welding or something like. So the entire integrated circuit is entire integrated component is really very challenging task, and a lot of research is involved in this. Now, a moderator, as I said, basically tries to slow down the neutrons from very high velocities, and hence the high energy level, which is coming out, that can be thermalized, and so that the probability of the neutron to hit the nuclear the nucleus of the uranium can be increased. And a lot of research on what kind of moderator to be used, or so depending on the failure of physics or the physics phenomenon of this nuclear process has been considered. And the main moderator that was used in our water, normal water, heavy water, graphite, beryllium. These are the main moderators that are being used in a different kind of, the nuclear energy. Just a moment. Hello? Hello? Yes?
Oh, sir? Sir, any problem, sir? Lalit, sir?
Yeah, I'm getting a call. Just a moment.
Yeah, okay, right.
Hello? Yeah. So the main moderator used are water, heavy water, graphite, and beryllium. Now the coolant, is basically used to remove the heat which has been accumulated in the reactor, and that heat can be transferred to water in a separate vessel, which is converted into the steam and runs the turbine. So the main coolant that are being used are water, carbon dioxide, mercury, helium. So these are the various coolants that are being used, and also it depends on the type of the reactor. Okay. So now the containment, as I said, the containment is basically envelop the main nuclear reactor and the steam generator. So the structure around the reactor and the associated steam generator, which is designed to protect it from outside intrusion, and to protect those outside from the effects of radiation in case of any serious malfunction inside. So it is typically 1 meter thick concrete and steel structure. So how it should be designed, and depending on the physics or depending on the process that are going, it all depends, how the containment has to be designed, and also it depends on the size of the nuclear reactor, the capacity of the nuclear reactor, basically. Now, if you consider the nuclear power plants in India, India is planning a huge increase in nuclear power. And it is like making nuclear power one of its key policy initiatives, with the plans to build almost 48 nuclear new reactors and to boost output to 63,000 megawatt by 2032. Almost 14-fold increase on the current levels. So the existing, if you see, there are the 20 nuclear reactors in India, and which are generating about 4,700 megawatt of energy. If you see this map, we do have the nuclear power plants in every geographical location of India. The notations that we have used, which are shown by the red bullets, those are already operating nuclear reactors. For example, if you see the Rajasthan, there is one nuclear reactor of 100 megawatt, one nuclear reactor of 200 megawatt, and four units of 220 megawatt. And this yellow, it means it is under construction. So two nuclear reactors of 700 megawatt are under construction. Similarly, if you see there is a green blue bullet, which is showing it is a proposed nuclear reactor, 4 × 700. So four units each of 700 megawatt. It is a proposed nuclear reactor. And you see Narora, that is in Uttar Pradesh, which is having already two units each of 220 megawatt. And in this way, you can see, we do have in nuclear reactors in almost every more number of states. If you see, there is a Russian project that is Kudankulam, which is in Kanyakumari, and which is already containing the two nuclear reactors each of 1000 megawatt, and four reactors are already proposed, which are under construction now. So this is the entire status of the nuclear reactors in India now. If you see, as I said, the nuclear reactors are of various types, and we can classify these nuclear reactors on the basis of various factors. For example, as I said, neutron energy. So some of the neutron in some of the nuclear reactors, there we require the thermal neutrons. We require some of the nuclear reactors, we require fast neutrons. So depending on that, we can classify the nuclear reactors which use these fast neutrons. Those reactors are known as fast reactors, and which uses slow neutrons or thermalized neutrons, such reactors are known as thermal reactors. Similarly, on the basis of fuel also, we can categorize the nuclear reactor, because the natural fuel, if we say, it contains uranium-235, very less amount of uranium-235, it is 0.03% only. And 99 point something, it contains uranium-238. And uranium-238 is not very much fissile. So there is a natural, so, but some of the reactors we make like from this, even if we are not having enriched uranium, that U-235, which are available in a very small quantity, that also will be sufficient for creating the heat energy. So depending accordingly, the geometrical shape, the kind of instruments, the mechanical components, the working mechanism differs. And on the basis of fuel also, we can categorize, like, because the fuel can be used as a natural fuel or enriched uranium, means we have to enrich the uranium. We have to increase the quantity of 235. There is so many, there are so many enrichment facilities where we can enrich the uranium. For example, if you can see the uranium fuel corporation of India Limited, and it basically works on enrichment of the uranium and how to manage the entire uranium. NFC, it is known as Nuclear Fuel Complex. It is in Hyderabad. So these are the various basically units of Department of Atomic Energy, which are working on all these kind of research, like what are the fuel to be used. So for that nuclear fuel complex, all the electronic related development, if you see, there is the Electronic Corporation of India Limited, which is in Hyderabad. The designing and research, you can see there's the computer division in Bar, right? So many, like each and every domain has to be considered, and for which each and every dedicated units are working. And for more and more research, there are some academic units also. For example, Homi Bhabha Institute of Homi Bhabha National Institute, HBNI, and like HRI Allahabad, Harishchand Research Institute, TIFR, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. So these are the different units of Department of Atomic Energy which are working for different kind of works, and ultimately the goal is like of nuclear reactor, nuclear energy. Similarly, on the basis of moderators, as I said, what kind of moderator can be used, it also depends on the type of the nuclear reactor. So as a moderator, that we can use the water moderator, heavy water moderator, graphite moderator, beryllium moderator, and then we can use the different coolant. So the different coolant that can be used in the reactor is water cooled like if I'm using ordinary water or heavy water, those reactors are known as water cooled reactors. Some are using gas, so are known as gas cooled reactors. Liquid metal cooled reactors, for example, there is a sodium reactor which is known as fast breeder reactor that is under construction in Kalpakkam, and it also Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research in Chennai, they have already made the test reactors for this liquid matter cooled reactor, and now the actual reactor is already, so many testing and all those analysis have been done on this prototype, and now the actual reactor is under construction, which is likely to be critical within like a couple of months. So some of the reactors are known as organic liquid cooled reactor, which are using the organic liquid as coolant. So if you see, like, the pressurized heavy water reactor, pressurized heavy water reactor means a pressure has to be built all the time in the nuclear reactor, in this reactor pressure vessel. And the reason is because it contains so much of heat energy, and all the coolant can be converted into the steam here itself. So that is why to reduce the boiling point, to increase the boiling point, we have to keep it pressurized. And that is why so much pressure has to be built. So accordingly, the engineering plays an important role, how it can be maintained so much of pressure throughout the life of the reactor in this reactor pressure, reactor vessel. And there is a pressurizer also. So, and other than all the working mechanism was like that only, the heat energy is, this coolant is transferring this heat energy of this reactor vessel into the steam generator, and it can again pump in the cool water, and this steam generator contains the two logical portion of two logical parts. One is the normal water, and when it touches on the knob with the normal water, it converts into the steam, and that is going to the turbine, which is again getting condensed and pumping into the steam generator, and that from the turbine it goes to the generator, and then it can connect to the grid, it can, and then from the grid it can be reached to all the consumers. So this is a pressurized heavy water reactor. Similarly, boiling water reactor. Now in the boiling water reactor, there is no pressurizer. Here we don't pressure, we don't have to pressurize this reactor vessel. So definitely the challenges to build the reactor vessel is very less, but a lot of other challenges involved. Why? Now this water is boiling here itself. In the reactor pressure, there is no boiler or steam generator. Steam generator is just a boiler because it is converted into the steam. So the water is boiling here, and that steam is directly going to the turbine. So here there is no steam generator, and the rest of the process is same. So if you see, in the boiling water reactor, lot of simplification of the design is there, but it includes a lot of challenges. So the advantage of the, if you see the advantages of the boiling water, is almost number of valves we have to use is 50% has been reduced. And if you saw the number of pumps, almost 35% has been reduced. Pipes, 80% has been removed. 45% of less seismic building volume, and 70% less cables, and all those the cost cutting. There is a lot of cost cutting, but it imposes a lot of challenges also. So because of the disadvantages, because there is a possibility of radioactive contamination in the turbine mechanism. Why? You can see now. Earlier, it was coupled to the steam generator, and it was also a part of the containment structure, and which is connected to the turbine through some other loop, secondary loop. But here, the primary loop itself is connected to the turbine. So turbine is very much coupled with this reactor vessel, and hence, there is a possibility, more possibility, that these radioactivity can transfer to the turbine, and which can... it means it has crossed this containment boundary. So if it has crossed, it means it is more likely to reach to the public, into the public domain. So safety precautions are needed, which can turn out to be costly. So definitely, we have to then devise the safety mechanism, what should be, and each and every, then the reliability of each and every component will be very high. And to obtain such high reliability again imposes a lot of challenges, capability depends on the capability of the engineers, the scientists, the research, sound research. So all these issues will be involved, are involved. But the wasting of steam is also there in the boiling water reactor, and hence there is a lower thermal efficiency, because almost all the steam is not able to get utilized. So only 3 to 5% by mass can be converted to steam per pass. Now, if you see, there is a control room in the reactor, which basically controls, which is a nervous system of any nuclear reactor. Basically, it controls almost all the systems and each and every system of the nuclear reactor. And the systems could be like, if you see, there are the control systems, which are generally used to control the reaction. And there are many control systems depending on like the segregation of the functions that we have done. And all those control systems has to be like, you know, interact with each other to accomplish the overall objective of the control of that nuclear reactor. And hence, there is, if I'm saying all these processing nodes are communicating, definitely here, the network engineer plays a very important role. The computer networks plays a very important role. What kind of algorithms needs to be designed so that there should not be any data packet loss? And what kind of, like, you know, the data transfer policy should be there. It should be TCP/IP based, or it should be UDP based. It all depends like on the criticality of the functions, and there should be a proper balance with respect to the criticality of the function, with respect to the performance and requirements of the system. Then if you will see in this control room, there are very big wall screen, and in which basically, suppose this is showing the fuel status. These are the fuel bundles. So many fuel bundles are there, and it is showing the status of each and every fuel bundle. So a lot of image processing techniques involved, because installing the camera in such a, we have to install the camera which should be able to sustain in such high temperatures. So definitely the such kind of camera again imposes a lot of challenges. And then capturing the data and then displaying it and then enlarging it, it involves image processing techniques as well as video processing techniques as well. In the computer science, if you will see like image processing, the computer networks. Now, one more important thing. These monitors are for only graphical user interface or graphical user displays. For example, there is a field sensor and which is capturing the data, and that data is being processed into the embedded system, because generally embedded systems are real-time systems. And if we are playing with a control system or safety critical systems, we have to take the action in real time, and even 1 second, 1 millisecond plays a very important role. So there are the processors which basically operates in few milliseconds, and hence the real-time systems are very important. So there are a lot of research in the real-time systems, which kind of operating system that can be used. And moreover, as per the regulatory standards, because each and every country which is running their nuclear business has two regulators. One is national regulator. If you see in India, national regulator is Atomic Energy Regulatory Board, AERB, and the international regulators are constituted by the members from the developed countries, and it is known as IAEA, that is International Atomic Energy Agency, which basically controls the nuclear program of the of every country in the world. So that is why, because the reason behind is nuclear cannot be confined in your country, the decision cannot be confined in your country itself, because the consequences will be very severe. And as I said, the half-life of the radioactive elements can range from few milliseconds to billion of years. You can see the condition of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Even the impact is still persisting. And that is the reason the International Atomic Energy Agency, the international regulator, who basically drive the nuclear program in the respective countries. And hence, each and every design has to be endorsed by the country regulator as well as the international regulator, depending on the type of the system that you are dealing with. So coming back, what I wanted to say, because so we cannot rely on third-party software. So even we develop our own operating system. We cannot rely on the third-party operating system. So definitely, there's a lot of research going on what kind of operating system needs to be designed, how all the real-time system information can be embedded, how what should be the priority interrupts that to be designed. All those research place comes into the picture, and then graphical user interface, what kind of international standards to be used so that it can be very convenient to the operator, because accordingly the operator has to take a quick action in case of some process parameter gets deviate from the normal range. So the design of the graphical user interface plays a very important role, so for which the IEEE international standards are available. And definitely the design of the software plays a very important role. What should be the software development life cycle? What are the various tools to be used for software engineering practices? So where the software engineering plays a very important role. And then if you can see the compilers, because we have to design our own compilers. Here the compiler design also plays a very important role. And if you can see, there are the electronic components in this control room that includes analog meters, digital meters, hand switches, and what kind of hand switches to be designed. Analog meters, digital meters to be designed. Those are the part of electronics engineers, and how it should be placed. Those are the part of the instrumentation engineer, basically. So these all plays a very important role. And then if you can see, there are a lot of screens inside this. So how the screens to be allocated, and what kind of system needs to be there. So it can be on the wall panel, or it can be into this the lower cabinet panel. So it all depends on the instrumentation engineer. A lot of research involves, like depending on the international practices that are being followed. So these and this is also one kind of like a wall panel. So here also, if you can see, there are the various systems status we can see, and there are a lot of controlling electronic switches, and there are a lot of alarm windows are there where the operator can be taken attention for in case of any parameter deviates from the normal range. So these are the various research scopes that are involved in the nuclear reactors. And if you see, in the commercial nuclear power plants in commercial operation or operable, what are the main countries that are involved in the construction of a particular reactor type. For example, pressurized water reactors are mainly the countries that are interested or that do have expertise, that is USA, France, Japan, Russia, China, South Korea, and how many numbers of reactors are there, what is the total capacity of these reactors, what are the fuel, and what are the coolant they are using, moderator they are using. So it is, this matrix is basically showing some of the important reactor type, all the reactor types, and what are the countries that are basically involved. And that depends on the expertise of that country, the requirements of that country, the model of that country, and the government decisions of that particular country. So that's all I wanted to talk about. So I think in conclusion, the participants would have understood the various domains of the nuclear reactor or the nuclear energy that are being used, and what are the research scopes basically that are there for for the construction of the nuclear power plant. So thank you. In case of any questions, I would be happy to answer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Lalit, sir. Mm-hmm. Let's wait for any, there were no questions are posted on Q&A, sir. Mm-hmm. Let's see, we'll give a open platform to any participants. Have got any queries? You can get doubts clarified. Hope no one is there with a query, sir.
Okay.
So nice, sir. That was a nice presentation. So you are given a broad explanation about the process of this power generation through these nuclear power plants and its importance in various aspects. You have also explored that the scope of research in different areas. So definitely I hope participants and all attendees might have enjoyed this. And people, those are looking forward to do something in this area of nuclear power plant processing and all, can find good research areas and all, where they can define and start doing, initiating with a small problems and can be implemented. It seems like one person raised in doubt, Rosie Haridos. Mm-hmm. I'll let them to speak to you, sir. Mm-hmm. Hello?
Yeah, hello.
Sir, I'm looking for a participant.
Okay, yeah.
They have raised a hand but not responding. Participants, if anyone has got doubts and queries, you can get the doubts clarified with Professor Lalit Singh, sir. Lalit sir, it seems like one question and answer from Vijay Lakshmi ma'am.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I'll let us speak to you.
Okay. Can you share the PPT? Yeah, I will. I can share the PPT to you, and you can share to the participants. That is
okay, sir. Yeah. Rosie Haridos, nothing, sir. Everything is good. Okay. And that's all, sir. Lalit sir, it seems no more questions from the participants.
Yeah, thank you.
So, participants, hope you people have enjoyed the presentation given by the Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh. And that was an excellent presentation from Lalit sir. We are very honored to have you here on this platform where you can share your knowledge to our all participants. That would definitely enhance their skills in enhancing the knowledge. And for the people, those are looking for different areas in which they would like to start their research activities and all, they can start and initiate their ideas with this input what you have given, and definitely it helps a lot for these attendees, those are looking for these areas. Once again, sir, from the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Geetham University, and from the management of Geetham University, I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitudes to Dr. Lalit Kumar Singh for sparing his valuable time to share the knowledge on this 5-day faculty development program. And hope participants enjoyed. And Lalit Kumar Singh, sir, we are always looking forward to have you here on this kind of platforms that we are about to conduct in future also. And yes, thank you very much for your support, sir. And that was an illustrative and elaborated explanation that you have presented on this topic. So maybe I request participants, if you still have any doubts, you can post on our group. So that can be conveyed to Lalit Kumar Singh, sir. And I request Lalit Kumar Singh, sir, if it is possible, you may please share the PPT with us. If anyone requests this, definitely we would share this, sir. And as you are requested that this is not going to be posted on a public domain. Right, sir?
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your presentation, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Thanks a lot, sir. I request participants to stay on the same link that we would be having one more session from Dr. K.R.V. Subramanian, sir. The professor is about to join this meeting. Let's wait for a few minutes. Actually, the time starts scheduled is at 2:00. So hope the professor would be joining soon. So I request all participants to be active on the same link. Thank you. Sir, good afternoon, sir. Subramaniam, sir.
Good afternoon, Rajshekar, sir.
Good afternoon. How are you, sir?
Yeah, fine, sir.
After a long time, sir, maybe yeah, this is a good opportunity to have interaction.
Yeah.
So, really, sir, participants are here. If you're ready, we will start, sir.
Okay, sir. Fine.
Right, sir.
Yeah, we can start.
Good afternoon, one and all, for this afternoon session. So, Professor K.R.V. Subramanian is this session's speaker from the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Geetham University, Bangalore campus. I would like to extend a warm welcome to Professor Subramanian. And good afternoon, one and all. We welcome you too on this five-day faculty development program, sir, sponsored by AICT ATAL. So Professor Subramanian is going to share his topic. It's titled as Ferrofluids and Nanofluids, Challenges and Opportunities. Today we are very happy, and it's a great honor for us to have Professor Subramanian, sir, on this platform to share his knowledge, and that could, expecting that could enlighten most of the researchers and would give a payment to the new researchers, those are looking forward to start their research activities and all. So definitely this would give a way for most of the researchers and could be an opportunity for the rest of the researchers, those who are already working on this area. So once again, I welcome you to this faculty development program, sir, Subramanian sir. And I would like to introduce Professor Subramanian. Dr. K.R.V. Subramanian is a professor right now with the Mechanical Engineering Department and is a co-research coordinator working for Ramaya Institute of Technology, Bangalore. His research interests are nanocomposites, solar energy, and nanofluids, nanotechnology and cancer, thermal interface, thermal barrier materials, energy storage nanomaterials, nanofabrication and nanodevices, nanothermoelectrics, carbon nanotubes, graphene-based sensors, microcapacitors, thermodynamic cycles, CO2 capture nanomaterials, and these are most of, like, almost all research areas that Professor Subramanian is working on. He earned his PhD from Cambridge University in the year 2006, specialized in nanotechnology. His bachelor's and master's degrees in materials engineering and are being obtained from NIT Trichy and IIT Bangalore. He has over 25 years of academic as well as industrial work experience. And professor has published more than 100 journals and conference papers and is the editor of 3 books. And professor has also got some like professionals like Who's Who of the World and IBC Top 100 Professionals. And he has been a co-principal investigator for many of the government-funded research projects. So today we are very great, lucky and honored to have such a eminent professor from MSRIT for sharing his, about to share his knowledge on the research areas, hoping helps a lot for all researchers and attendees. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for being with us on this session. So now I request Professor Subramanian to please share your screen and you may start the session sharing the PPT, sir.
Thank you, Rajshekar, sir, for your kind words and kind introduction.
Thank you, sir.
Everybody, so I will start the session now. So the topic of today's session is ferrofluids and nanofluids, challenges and opportunities. So as Rajshekar sir rightly said, I am working as a professor in mechanical engineering with Ramaya Institute of Technology, MSRIT, Bangalore, as well as co-research coordinator. So what are ferrofluids, right? Let us first start with the topic of ferrofluids. So a ferrofluid is a stable colloidal suspension of ferromagnetic or ferrimagnetic particles in a liquid, right? So the particles can be either ferromagnetic or ferrimagnetic. And they were discovered as early as 1960s. So it is not a very recent kind of a topic, but very interesting topic. So it was discovered by the US NASA, National Aeronautics and Space Administration Research Center. And they were investigating the methods of controlling the liquids in space. So basically they found out that in the absence of gravity, the magnetic fields could control the location of a ferrofluid, right? So this was the first research which was carried out on the topic of ferrofluids way back in the 1960s. Since then, in the topic has grown by leaps and bounds, and it has now become a very, very current topic. So let us go a little bit deeper into the ferrofluids. So what are ferrofluids? Ferrofluids often consist of ferrite nanoparticles. So what I mean by ferrite is either magnetite, which is Fe3O4, or magamite, which is a variation of the iron oxide in an oil suspension. And the particles, the particles of the ferrite structure, they are around 10 nanometers in diameter, or they can even be smaller. And they are coated with the surfactant molecules, such as oleic acid. And the reason why the surfactant molecules are used is because, it is to prevent the agglomeration. And these ferrofluids have found application during the last 40 years. And the magnetic liquids have been used in a large number of applications. There are several review papers on ferrofluids, and their applications also have been published extensively. So it is a very well researched topic. So what are some of the important applications of ferrofluids? So for example, if you take rotating shaft seals. So for example, if you have a rotating shaft and you have a seal on the shaft, which will prevent the leakage. So here the ferrofluid behaves as a liquid O-ring with low friction, right? And this can be used to maintain a large pressure difference between the two sides of the seal. The ferrofluid is held in place by permanent magnets. So if you want to actually fix the location of the ferrofluid, you have to have a magnet which is surrounding the ferrofluid. So this is one interesting application. Then ferrofluid seals are also used in vacuum chambers as well as in computer disk drives to prevent the pollution of the hard disk by dust particles. So that is also one more interesting application. Another important application is in loudspeakers. So if you take a loudspeaker, for example, an alternating current is applied to the coil, which is placed in a magnetic field. And this magnetic field is produced by permanent magnets.
Sir Subramaniam, sir, sorry yes. to interrupt you, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, that screen, you can put it in a slide mode, which okay, will come fine. As a full screen.
Yeah, sir. Yeah, sure. Yeah, definitely.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, now it's okay, sir.
Yeah, fine. Okay.
Okay.
So another important application is in loudspeakers, as I told you. So basically, the vibrations of the coil, they produce the sound in the loudspeaker. So in many of the modern loudspeakers, you can see that the coil is moving in a ferrofluid, which is held in place by a permanent magnet, right? So these are some of the, day-to-day applications as well as important applications of ferrofluids. There are, of course, many, many more applications, but these are some of the applications I thought I can highlight. So ferrofluids, as the term suggests, the dynamics is a little bit complex. So let us see, let us look into the little bit of the dynamics of the ferrofluids. So basically in the ferrofluids, the magnetic and the liquid states coexist, right? So on the surface, they look like very simple systems. I mean, basically they consist of a homogeneous phase, the magnetic particles, then the surfactant and the liquid carrier. So only three components are there. So on the surface of it, it looks very simple, but there is a lot of complexity behind this systems. So there is a complex chemistry, and there is also a balance of interparticle forces, which determine the colloidal stability. So basically, one of the things in ferrofluids is, people have been trying a lot of years to avoid the agglomeration as well as the sedimentation of the particles. So basically, the size of the magnetic particles must be below a critical limit such that, the Brownian motion opposes the tendency for agglomeration and sedimentation due to gravitation. So basically, there are, opposing forces here. One is the force which will cause it to agglomerate and also settle down. The other one is the Brownian motion, which opposes the agglomeration. So agglomeration of the particles, it is promoted by a couple of forces. One is the magnetic dipole interaction and the van der Waals forces. Now, this is, you know, in the case when surfactant is not used. I mean, I'm talking about the situation where the surfactant is not used. So what are the requirements of a normal ferrofluid system, right? Let us look at the requirements. So the magnetite particles, you know, the Fe3O4 particles must be in the range of 10 nanometers. So very, very small dimension. The surfactant, you know, all of you, I think, are familiar with surfactant molecules. So there is a tail of a surfactant should be long enough to prevent particle agglomeration. And here, you know, both the properties influence the device performance. One is the magnetic property, other one is the liquid property. And since we are talking about, you know, the magnetization behavior of this nanoparticles or, you know, this ferrite particles, there is something called saturation magnetization values, which range from 0.0001 to 0.1 Tesla, right? So this is the normal magnetization values of these ferrofluids. And coming to the liquid properties, you know, there are various properties. Some of you are familiar already with these properties. There is viscosity, there is volatility, there is working temperature range, there is environmental compatibility, there is thermal degradation, there is dielectric behavior. So all these, you know, are liquid properties, right? So that determines, you know, what kind of liquid you want to use to disperse these nanoparticles. And of course, you know, the viscosity range of the liquid medium, it falls in the range of 1 to 2000 centipoise at room temperature. And there are, of course, you know, many carrier fluids which are used. So some of them are oils, you know, the normal oils, then synthetic esters, hydrocarbons, then even water can be used as a medium for dispersing the ferrofluids. Then, of course, you know, other solvents like organic solvents, etc. So these are all the requirements from a ferrofluid system. So let us look into the processes in ferrofluids, right? So what are the processes involved in ferrofluids? So as I told you, the ferrofluid is a colloidal suspension of single domain particles dispersed in a carrier liquid and stabilized by a surfactant. Now, single domain particles are particles which are in a state of uniform magnetization. So the magnetic behavior is very important here because, as I told you in the earlier slides, the ferrofluid is held in place by the magnetic field, which is applied on the outside, right? So the magnetization properties are very important. So ferrofluids are characterized by a magnetization curve, which displays no hysteresis. So I think some of you are familiar with the normal magnetization behavior. You know, most of the magnetization behavior, if you plot the magnetization versus the magnetic field strength, then normally a hysteresis behavior is observed. But in the case of ferrofluids, there is no hysteresis behavior. Hysteresis is nothing but a cycling behavior. You know, it goes to the maximum, then it comes down, go to the minimum, and again goes to the maximum. So this is kind of a cyclic behavior. Now, if you take the measurement of the susceptibility of a, you know, ferrofluid, it involves a measurement of inductance and the resistance of the suspension, right? And of course, you know, you also should know the frequency range. So that is determined by the size of the magnetic particles and the mechanism of relaxation. Now in magnetic ferrofluids, there are two types of relaxation mechanisms. One is by diffusion, which is Brownian diffusion. Other one is by Neel relaxation, right? So obviously, you know, the most dominant process will be the one which has the shortest relaxation time. So both the mechanisms contribute to the magnetization in the case of ferrofluids, both Brownian mechanism as well as Neel mechanisms. So we will see a little bit more on what these mechanisms are. So basically, you know, like in ferrofluids, you have something called as external magnetization direction, which is called as EMD, right? So obviously, you know, like if you apply an external magnetic field to a ferrofluid, the particles in the ferrofluid will align along with the EMD or the external magnetic field. So how do they do that? There are two ways of doing it. So if you look at the diagram, right? So this is the, you know, H is the applied magnetic field and M is the magnetization vector of the ferrofluid. So there are two ways it can align. One is the magnetization vector can rotate so that it is parallel to the magnetic field, or the particle itself can rotate. So can you see in B, you know, what happens is the vector rotates, so that the M is parallel to H. Whereas in C, you know, the particle rotates so that M is parallel to H. So both these things are possible, right? So the first process is called as a Neel process, where, you know, the magnetization vector rotates. And the second process where the particle rotates is called as a Brownian process, right? So obviously, you know, as with any relaxation processes, there are times involved with it. There is a relaxation time for both the Neel process as well as Brownian process. So the most important process is the Brownian relaxation, because I think some of you are already familiar that, you know, ferrofluids and nanofluids are used for heat transfer applications. So obviously, you know, the whatever controls the heat transfer is the one we are interested in. So the Brownian relaxation is more important, which involves a rotation of the particle, right? So the heat is transferred to the liquid by the rotational processes. So once the particle rotates to align with the external magnetic field, that is how the heat is transferred to the carrier liquid. So there are some time constants involved. So let us see, you know, the rotation of the particles in the fluid. The Brownian time constant is given by this expression, right? So it involves, you know, the fluid viscosity. It involves the volume VH, it involves a Boltzmann constant and temperature. And the volume itself is given by this expression, 1 plus delta by R the whole cubed into Vm, where Vm is a spherical volume. So R is called as the nanoparticle radius, Vm is the volume, and delta is the surfactant radius. Now, this is what we have seen as the Brownian time constant. The same thing, you can look for a Neel time constant. So for example, you know, the Neel time constant is given by this expression, K into Vm by Kb into T, right? So K is called as anisotropy energy density, Vm is a volume, Kb is a Boltzmann constant, and T is the temperature, right? And the Neel time constant is given by a complicated expression as given by this formula. So it is, you know, root of pi by 2 into the Td into exponential T by T power 3 by 2, right? So it involves, you know, the diffusional time constant, and it also involves, you know, the volumetric factor which is involved. So basically, you know, like in both the formulas, we have seen that particle volume is a parameter. So therefore, you know, the particle morphology or the shape plays a very important role in determining which process will dominate. And the total relaxation time is given by 1 by T is equal to 1 by Brownian time plus 1 by Neel time, right? So basically, you know, like the idea is, the ferrofluid is made up of monodispersed particles, then the size can be chosen such that the relaxation is dominated by the dissipative Brownian mechanism. So of the two mechanisms, the Brownian mechanism is more preferred because it is a dissipative process and it leads to heat transfer to the carrier fluid. So this is a typical synthesis procedure for the ferrofluid. So it is not very complicated. I mean, I have just given some important steps. So for example, you know, this is the this is what is required for a production of a Fe3O4 ferrofluid. So you take ferrous chloride hydrated and you take ferric chloride hydrated, right? They, you mix them together in water, then you add some ammonia, then the precipitate will form. You collect it with a permanent magnet, and then obviously, you know, that you'll have the supernatant. Then you take the precipitate and add nitric acid and, you know, ferrous nitrate. And then again, you will have another precipitate, which is redispersed in DM water. And then, you know, like you add some more water to the precipitate. And then you add oleic acid, which is a surfactant. Then you dry the entire system in a nitrogen flow. And then, you know, you are able to produce that surfactant coated Fe3O4 particles. And then you finally redisperse in a cyclohexane so that you can form a stable dispersion. Now, this particular ferromagnetic system can be manipulated with a magnet, That is what is the speciality of the system. So how do you characterize these systems? Obviously, you know, there are a number of techniques available to do that. So first technique is the transmission electron microscopy, or TEM. Since these particles are very small in size, you need the TEM. Then, of course, you know, if you want to characterize thermal properties, you can make use of thermogravimetry, then FTIR, then finite element method, and then magnetohydrodynamics, which is called MHD. Then you can make use of dynamic light scattering and zeta potential to get the stability of the nanoparticles. Then to measure the magnetic properties, you can make use of magnetic hysteresis and power dissipation measurements. So these are all possible with the help of magnetic measurement equipments. Then you can also measure other parameters like permeability, susceptibility, loss tangent, etc. So these are some of the important parameters which are characterized for these systems. So what are the challenges in making or studying these ferrofluids? The first challenge is, if you make use of synthesize a ferrofluid with greater stability, that is one of the challenges, right? So although we are making use of surfactants and you are making use of proper dissipation methods, stability has to be improved. Then you should also get stable ferrofluids in liquid metal carrier, right? So obviously, it should be compatible with the carrier fluid. Then you should also get ferrofluids which are suitable for heating and cooling cycles. So suppose, you synthesize a ferrofluid and you subject it to, repeated heating and cooling, then that should be able to withstand that hysteresis, temperature hysteresis. Then another thing is, you should also have materials which are oxidation stable and which have high magnetic moment, right? So both these are important. And then they should also have high saturation moments. So that is also important. Then of course, nowadays ferrofluids are also used for protein, studies. So for example, these ferrofluid particles are connected to protein species for drug delivery and medical imaging. So how do you conjugate the ferrofluid particles with proteins? So that is a challenge. And then suppose, you want to deposit these ferrofluids in different patterns, then you have to make ferrofluid inks. So how do you develop these ferrofluid inks in different colors so that, you can deposit them on various substrates and you can actually create patterned media, storage media. So that is also a challenge. Then how do you produce ferrofluids with a greater monodispersity? So monodisperse means having almost one particle size. So that is not a trivial thing. It is somewhat difficult. And then of course, people are also making ferrofluid composites. So it is not just, Fe3O4. They actually mix this Fe3O4 with other magnetic materials and they produce composites with tailored properties. So these are some of the challenges, which people are still working on. And they are at various stages of the study. So I have just covered the topic of ferrofluids. So ferrofluid is, relatively, as I said, it is not so recent. It is somewhat older, but nevertheless, the field of study is still evolving and there are a number of challenges to be faced, right? So that needs to be addressed, especially going forward, how are these various challenges that is going to be addressed. So I hope you have got the basics of ferrofluids and its applications, its properties, its characterization, and its, what are the challenges to be faced. So I will take the questions, some questions towards the end, right? So now let us go to the topic of nanofluids. So nanofluid, it is like a broader category. So what I mean is, if I take nanofluids is a broader category under which the ferrofluids will be one of the subcategories. So the field of ferrofluids, has evolved to the field of nanofluids. So what are nanofluids? They are solid liquid composite materials consisting of solid nanoparticles or nanofibers. So it's not just restricted to nanoparticles. You can also have nanofibers. And typically the size range is 1 to 100 nanometers. Again, it is suspended in a liquid. So it is characterized by two things. One is the high particle mobility, and also, you know, you have large surface area to volume ratio, right? So why it has attracted the interest, you know, why people just did not stick to ferrofluids and, you know, wanted to do more research in nanofluids. So it has attracted interest because of the reports of greatly enhanced thermal properties. Some of its thermal properties, as we will see in the subsequent slides, are relatively very interesting and very enhanced. So for example, you know, I'm just giving you some examples. So if you just take, you know, a very, very small amount, say less than 1% volume fraction, and if you take copper nanoparticles, or even if you take carbon nanotubes, right? So these are all nanosystems. And if you disperse them in ethylene glycol or oil, then the thermal conductivity of the ethylene glycol or oil is very poor. But if you have these nanosystems dispersed, then the conductivity increases by 40% and 150% respectively. So there is a very large increase in the thermal conductivity. And if you take conventional systems, you know, for example, if you want to get the same, you have to actually have a very high volume fraction, more than 10% of the particles. So the advantage of nanofluids is with a very, very small concentration, less than 1%, you can achieve large increases in the thermal properties. And of course, you know, like the question is, you know, like what is the advantage of low concentration? See, especially when you go to high concentration of particles, you are having problems of rheology and stability, right? So for example, you know, like all of you know that in heat transfer fluids, people make use of conventional particles and conventional slurries, but you know, there are problems of stability and rheology. So that is overcome in the case of nanofluids. So what is the need for the research and development in this area? So most of you know that, you know, cooling is one of the most important areas in mechanical engineering and other parts of engineering, like, you know, microelectronics or even transportation or manufacturing. Right, most of you are aware that, you know, if you have to do some machining operations, you have to have cooling systems, proper cooling systems. So that is the reason, you know, like why this system, nanofluid system, has evolved, right? So basically, you know, like it can actually take more thermal loads, and it can actually without deterioration. So that is the reason, you know, why this field of study has evolved. So the conventional method of, you know, increasing the heat dissipation is to increase the area available for the exchanging the heat with the heat transfer fluid. So some of you are familiar with the heat exchangers. So it basically goes with the area, right? But you know, like suppose you have higher area or you have a more complex area, then it requires a large increase in the thermal management system size. So that is not always preferable. So that is why, you know, like there is a need for developing new and innovative coolants with improved performance. So that is why the concept of nanofluids has come in, which are again, you know, it's a abbreviation for heat transfer fluids containing suspensions of nanoparticles. So that is why it has been proposed as an alternative for meeting these challenges. So how did this field evolve? The first study was done by an American scientist, Choi, in 1995. And he has published this paper, which is enhancing thermal conductivity of fluids with nanoparticles. So it was actually published in the American Society of Mechanical Engineers. So this was one of the seminal papers which actually introduced the field to the scientific community. So what are the steps involved in the synthesis of nanofluids? So very, very simple steps, right? So you can have nanoparticles of oxides, nitrides, metals, metal carbides, or nanometals, right, or non-metals. And you may use surfactants or may not use surfactants. And these can be dispersed into fluids such as water, ethylene glycol, or oils. So these are the simple ways of, you know, producing the nanofluids. So there are different methods of producing the nanofluids. The first one is called as a two-step process. So what is a two-step process? The first one is, the first step is the nanoparticles or nanotubes are produced by a dry powder, and one of the methods used is inert gas condensation. Of course, you know, you can also use a CVD process, chemical vapor deposition, especially for producing the multi-walled carbon nanotubes. Then the second step is you have to disperse these nanoparticles or nanotubes into a fluid, which is called a second step. So what are the simple techniques? The simple techniques are ultrasonic agitation, or you know, the addition of surfactants. And using this second step, you can disperse the particles properly in the fluid. And it works well in some of the cases, you know, especially when you have nanofluids consisting of oxide nanoparticles dispersed in water. But, you know, like suppose you go for heavier metallic nanoparticles, then sometimes this two-step process does not work very well. So these are some of the examples, you know, like of the nanofluids which are produced by two-step method. So you can see the middle figure. That consists of copper oxide nanoparticles, which are dispersed in ethylene glycol. So this is an example of a nanofluid, right? And so as opposed to the two-step method, you have one-step method. So what is one-step method? Basically, there are no discrete steps. You know, here the nanofluids, they contain the dispersed metal nanoparticles. They have been produced by a technique called as a direct evaporation technique. So what you do is you it involves a vaporization of a source material under vacuum conditions, and you know directly, you know, the deposition and dispersion happens in one step. There are no separate steps. It happens in one step, right? But of course, you know, there are some limitations, like, you know, if you want to make use of the direct evaporation technique, the low vapor pressure fluids are to be used, right? And of course, you can also make use of chemical synthesis techniques, which are all single step to produce the nanofluids. One of the most popular techniques is a technique developed by Bruce and co-workers. So those of you who are familiar with the synthesis of gold nanoparticles and silver nanoparticles, you know that Bruce method is one of the most common techniques. So it involves, you know, producing the metallic nanoparticles by reduction of metal salts. And these have been used to produce the colloidal suspensions in various solvents, right? And this method is very commonly used for producing the nanofluids also. And the advantage of the Bruce method is you have excellent control of size, and you can get very narrow size distribution by obtaining, by following this method. So what are the key thermal properties of nanofluids? So the first property is the thermal conductivity. I told you that the values are very much high as compared to traditional solid liquid suspensions. And there is a non-linear relationship between thermal conductivity and concentration, right? So it is not a linear relationship. That means, you know, if you add a little bit of volume fraction, normally you expect some increase in the conductivity. But in this case, it is a non-linear relationship. And of course, you know, there is a strongly temperature dependent thermal conductivity, and there is also significant increase in the heat flux and boiling heat transfer. So these are some of the key thermal properties of nanofluids. So let us see, you know, what are all the experiments which people have done with different nanoparticles. So I have just, you know, quoted some references. Those of you who are interested in the references, you can get in touch later on. So for example, you know, if you add about 4% volume percent alumina, Al2O3 nanoparticles, then you get 30% increase in the thermal conductivity. And these nanoparticles are dispersed in water. Then, for example, you know, another reference, they have studied the same alumina nanoparticles in water, but they got only 15% enhancement in the thermal conductivity. So the reason why they ascribed it was the particle size was different in both the cases. Then some more people have studied, you know, they have got an intermediate result. For example, the thermal conductivity of water is enhanced by 20%. If you have a volume fraction of 5%, then some more people have studied copper oxide nanoparticles in water. They have observed a 17% increase in thermal conductivity, and the loading is only about 0.4 volume percent. Then some of the people, you know, they have studied that if you take an ethylene glycol based nanofluid, then the thermal conductivity increased by 40%, and the volume fraction was only about 0.3 volume percent. And yet another study, they increased the thermal conductivity by 21% when you disperse silver and gold nanoparticles in water and toluene, right? And the nanoparticle loading was very low. It was only about 0.01 volume percent. So these are, you know, these are just a gist of, you know, some of the studies where people have reported consistently that the thermal conductivity of the nanofluids is increased by a very, very low dispersion in the nanofluid. So this graph, you know, it shows the different nanosystems. So for example, it's a plot of increase in thermal conductivity versus nanoparticle loading. So you have the different nanoparticles like gold, copper, alumina, silicon carbide, copper oxide, etc. So you can see that, you know, for some of the nanofluids, the increase is very large, especially for gold, silver, copper oxide nanofluids. And some of the recent studies, what they have seen is there is a large enhancement in thermal conductivity for high concentration of oxide nanoparticles, as well as low concentrations of oxide metal nanoparticles. So both the cases, you know, you get a large increase in the thermal conductivity. So for example, you know, in this case, there is a 2- to 4-fold increase in the thermal conductivity. So that is a significant increase. Of course, you know, like one of the systems which is studied and very interesting is the carbon nanotube nanofluids. So for example, you know, like if you disperse 1% nanotube in water and you study the thermal properties, then 125% increase in thermal conductivity has been reported. And similarly, you know, like another reference, they have loaded up to 1 volume percent, and they have found that if you take multi-walled carbon nanotubes and disperse in oil suspensions, you get 160% enhancement. Right. So basically, you know, like it seems that, you know, at very low volume fractions, especially approaching 1 volume percent, the enhancement is significant. You know, 125%, 160% is very huge. Right. So these are very interesting values. And of course, you know, there is the other spectrum also. So people have reported lower enhancements in thermal conductivity. For example, you know, like people have prepared a carbon nanotube with organic liquids, and they have found only 20% increase at 1 volume percent loading. Similarly, another reference, they have got an enhancement of 38% with about 0.6% nanotubes in water. And the third reference has found 25% enhancement with about 0.8 volume percent carbon nanotubes in water. So these are, you know, both spectra. What I mean is you have the spectra where you have higher enhancement, and then you have the spectra where there is lower enhancement. But the trend is there, you know, the trend is there that there is enhancement. So now let us come to the concepts, or, you know, the studies on convective heat transfer in nanofluids. So all of you are familiar with the different types of heat transfer. So you have conduction, convection, and radiation. So specifically, we are concentrating on convective heat transfer. So one of the most important parameters is the heat transfer coefficient, right? All of you are familiar with the heat transfer coefficient. So it depends not only on the thermal conductivity, but also on the other properties of the nanofluid, such as heat, density, then dynamic viscosity, etc. So these are some of the studies, you know, where people have studied the effect on convective heat transfer. So if you take a nanofluid of copper oxide nanoparticles and disperse it in water with about loading of about 0.9 volume percent, then the heat transfer coefficient is increased by 15%, right? Then again, you know, people have prepared, you know, this copper nanoparticles in water about 2 volume percent, and they have found that the heat transfer coefficient and friction factor that increases in turbulent flow. So that improves the convective heat transfer remarkably. Then yet another group has studied the heat flux in a pool of boiling alumina water suspension, and they have found a 3-fold increase over that of pure water. So, you know, there is a positive effect on the heat transfer coefficient as well as the boiling heat transfer coefficient. So yet another group, you know, they measured the heat flux in pool boiling on a flat copper surface which is immersed in the nanofluid, alumina water nanofluid, and they have found a threefold increase in the critical heat flux, right? So basically they found that, you know, not only the average size of the bubbles increases, but the bubble frequency also decreases, right? And then people have conducted other experiments with silica water nanofluids. So, you know, at very, very low concentrations of the order of 10 power minus 3 volume percentage, they have found that there is a dramatic increase in the critical heat flux. So let us see the effect of the heat transfer in a nanofluid with external magnetic field. So in this case, the nanofluid is Fe3O4 water, right? It is a simple system. And what is measured is the flow and heat transfer in a semi-annulus enclosure in the presence of an external magnetic field, right? So basically, you know, the volume fraction of magnetic of the nanoparticles varies between 0 and 4%. And the Rayleigh number is varied as 10 power 3, 10 power 4, and 10 power 5. I think all of you are familiar with these numbers. Then there is something called magnetic number, which is varied as 0, 20, 60, and 100. There is a radiation parameter because of the high temperature. So that is varied between two values. There is a magnetic number called Hartmann number, which is also varied as 0, 2, 6, and 10. And some of the numbers are kept constant, like Prandtl number is kept constant at 6.8. There is a temperature number and Eckert number, which are kept constant at these values. That is 0 and 10 power minus 5. So look at this diagram. So you can see that this is an isotherm and streamlines, which is there between nanofluid. Nanofluid is on the left-hand side and normal fluid is on the right-hand side. So these values are for the specific values of, you know, the radiation parameter, then the, you know, the Hartmann number and the Prandtl number. So you can see that in the case of the nanofluid, the velocity components of nanofluid are increased, right? Because that is due to the increase of the energy transport in the fluid with increase in the volume fraction. So, you know, these lines, these flow lines, they transport the energy, right? The flow lines transport the energy. And it is also seen that the thermal boundary layer thickness increases with the increase of volume fraction of nanofluid. That means, you know, if you have a higher volume fraction, the thermal boundary layer thickness also increases. So you can look at this diagram. So all of you are familiar with the Nusselt number, right? Nusselt number is nothing but the product of the Reynolds number and the Prandtl number. So for example, you know, like in this diagram, on the top side, the Reynolds number is 10 power 3. And as you go from top to bottom, the Reynolds number increases, right? So at the bottom side, you have higher Reynolds number. So you can see that, you know, as the Rayleigh number increases, the role of convection in the heat transfer becomes more significant, right? And what you can see that, you know, what is shown in the red color, you know, boundary, that shows the thermal boundary layer thickness. That shows the thermal boundary layer thickness. So obviously, you know, like as you go from, you know, lower Rayleigh number to higher Rayleigh number, the thermal boundary layer thickness decreases. It becomes thinner, right? So these are some of the studies, you know, especially with the nanofluid. So again, you know, you can see some of the variations of different parameters, especially finally on the Nusselt number. So you can see the variation of Nusselt number versus Hartmann number. You can see the variation of Nusselt number versus, you know, the dimensionless parameter, Xi. Right, so these are for different values of Hartmann number, Rayleigh number, and then they are also for different values of you know, the magnetic number as well as the Hartmann number. So you can see that the Nusselt number generally increases with higher Rayleigh number. Right, you can see that whenever the Rayleigh number goes from 10 power 3 to 10 power 5, the Nusselt number also increases. Right, and The same trend is shown in the left-hand side of the diagram, where you have Nusselt number versus the Hartmann number. So especially for 10 power 5 Rayleigh number, the Nusselt number is quite high. So how do you understand this thermal conductivity of nanofluids, right? So there is a theory called as effective medium theory. So this theory states that in the limit of a small volume fraction of nanoparticles, all the versions of the theory converge to the same solution. And if you take, you know, like high thermal conductivity particles, the nanofluids thermal conductivity enhancement will be 3 times the normal conductivity. So one of the things that is proposed is, you know, if you have an aggregate of nanoparticles, it occupies more space than the individual nanoparticles, right? So obviously, you know, the volume fraction of aggregates is larger than the volume fraction of nanoparticles. So a random close packing of spherical nanoparticles has a density of approximately 60%. So if the nanoparticles are aggregated, you can expect an enhancement in the thermal conductivity of 3 times the original volume fraction divided by 0.6, which is 5 times the enhancement. So obviously, you know, what is causing the large increase in the thermal conductivity? So one of the things is the thermal motion of nanoparticles. So as I told you earlier, as in the case of ferrofluids, the Brownian motion plays a very important role as compared to the Neel motion. So, you know, the Brownian motion or the Brownian process is a more efficient heat transfer mechanism than the Neel process, right? And there is something called thermal diffusion, which is different from Brownian diffusion. So the thermal diffusion is much more faster than Brownian diffusion. So, you know, Brownian diffusion is because of the random diffusion of the particles due to Brownian motion, whereas thermal diffusion is under the gradient of the thermal field, right? So basically, you know, like, but people have also emphasized that Brownian motion driven convection is more prominent. So what are the challenges in the nanofluids? You know, there are a lot of positive things which are shown. But there are a lot of challenges still existing in this field. So one of the challenges, you know, there is a lack of agreement between results obtained in different laboratories. So what may be the reason? The reason may be in the preparation of the systems, you know, in the characterization of the systems, and also the measurements taken and the interpretation of the measurements, right? So you may not get consistent results always. And people, you know, they don't characterize the suspensions properly. So I told you number of methods to characterize, but sometimes, you know, they don't characterize it properly. And there is also a lack of theoretical understanding of the mechanisms responsible for the observed changes in the properties. So there is also a problem, you know, regarding the stability of the nanofluid suspensions. So for example, you know, like sometimes the stability may not be so good even after, you know, you use the surfactants and all that. So sometimes you may have aggregation or you may have extended structures. So that may be responsible for the disagreement between experimental results and the theoretical results. And sometimes, you know, people study thermal conductivity and viscosity together to give much better interpretation of the results. And some of the aggregation may also be beneficial, right? Especially if you take, you know, nanotubes. Then if you have nanotube suspensions and composites, then aggregation is somewhat detrimental because, you know, the bundling of the nanotubes can reduce the fiber aspect ratio. Then another challenge is in the size distribution of the nanoparticles. So I told you earlier in the ferrofluids, especially that, you know, monodisperse is better, but this kind of monodispersity is not always achieved, right? So sometimes you may have size distribution. So how do you determine the size distribution? Normally you make use of TEM, transmission electron microscopy, but you know that, you know, not all the laboratories have TEM. So then, you know, like it may be difficult to use the TEM for measuring the size distribution. Of course, you use the TEM under low temperatures. So it is called as cryogenic TEM. Another limitation or challenge is the sample sizes. So most of the studies of nanofluid, you know, they take only a few hundred milliliters of nanofluid, right? Suppose you want to do more extensive studies, then you should look at larger samples. And you know, like one of the other challenges is the robust techniques for large scale production. So I told you about two techniques, the two-step method and the one-step method. But suppose you want to produce the nanofluids on a very, very large scale, then you should have very reliable techniques. So that is also one of the things to be considered. And one of the other challenges in nanofluids is the interfacial thermal resistance. So basically, you know, like you have, suppose you have high interfacial thermal resistance, then, you know, you lose the advantage of using the nanofluids. For example, you know, if you make use of nanotube, carbon nanotubes, and if the interfacial resistance is very high, then the thermal conductivity may not result. And sometimes, you know, like there is also the problem of phonons. So suppose, you know, you have this thermal waves, which are phonons, if they are scattered by defects, then, you know, the intrinsic thermal connectivity is reduced. Now, there are also challenges regarding the boiling heat transfer. As I told you earlier, you know, large increases in the heat flux has been reported, but this requires more study because, you know, like people have to understand the mechanisms and, you know, why the bubbles, you know, produced in the way, you know, by using nanofluids. So that needs to be understood better. So still the increases are unknown at this time, you know, why it's increasing. That is not completely known, right? So that those are the things to be understood. So coming to convective heat flow, obviously, you know, that is the thing which is of most importance. So based on the literature, you know, what I have shown you, it has shown that, you know, like there is a significant increase in the heat transfer coefficient under forced flow conditions as well as the boiling experiments. But there are contradictory studies also. So what I mean is, in some cases, you know, you may have increase in heat transfer coefficient. In some cases, there is a decrease in the heat transfer coefficient, right? So those things are to be better understood. And you should also systematically identify the factors leading to the enhancement or deterioration of this convective heat flow characteristics, right? So these are the things to be taken care of. So I would kind of summarize and, you know, try to give a, you know, final remarks on these kind of systems. So these enhanced thermal properties of nanofluids and ferrofluids are, they are not just academic interest. You know, they can be used in a wide range of practical applications, and especially they can be used where thermal management is required, you know, especially in machining operations like coolants, electronic for microelectronics and, you know, other related fields. And nowadays, you know, like they are also being used in medical applications such as cancer therapy. So it makes it all the more interesting, you know, and important why these properties have to be understood. And it is a, there is a lot of opportunity for exploration and discovery, you know, of the latest trends, right? So that is one of the reasons, you know, why these systems are very important. So I come to the end of this talk, and I can field a few questions. Rajshekar, I have completed.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm here, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
That was a wonderful presentation from Professor Subramanian. Has given a total idea about what is a nanofluid, what is its importance, and provided with a good support of a literature has also been explained with the professor. And where people can find, attendees can find very good scope of these nanofluids, various applications, and the attendees, maybe some of the attendees are maybe fresh for this kick up the research activities, can also choose a particular topics, the specialized topics from these areas. And sir, professor has already explained briefly the synthesis and various characterization, whereas different parameters are required to just characterize these nanofluids are being very briefly and very illustratedly explained by the professor. Thank you very much, sir. Subramanian, sir.
Let us look for some
questions, sir. Like there was no questions posted on Q&A.
Okay.
Like if anyone is interested, participants, you may get an opportunity to straight away speak to the professor for getting any doubts if you have to clarify.
Yeah, I'll be happy to take a few questions.
See, sir.
Yeah.
One person raised a hand, Purushottam. Purushottam, sir, are you there? You have raised a hand. Do you have any query, sir? No, maybe he's not active.
Okay.
Seems, sir, there were no questions from the participants.
Okay.
Still, people, students are, sorry, attendees, if you have any queries, that you can please post your queries on our group. So that can be conveyed to Professor Subramanian and we will get the things getting clarified.
Yeah, sure. Still, I'll be happy to do that.
Sir, Subramanian, sir, that was a very good explanation you have given. Sir, yes. I have a small question.
Yes, sir.
So what about this, stabilization seems to be nowadays, it's a very tough task.
Yeah.
For these nanofluids.
Yeah.
Like as you mentioned, there were two, one-way method is there, two-way method is there.
Yes.
Hope I need to understand a lot about these stabilizations. Well, I'm just planning to work on a nano lubricant.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Actually, normally some surfactants are used, especially this surfactants like oleic acid or, there are this SDS, sodium dodecyl sulfate or there are many of this, polymeric surfactants, which
yes,
can actually coat this nanoparticles and make them more stable, actually.
Mm.
So... only thing is, of the two methods, single step method is somewhat difficult.
Yes, sir.
So two step, you can easily prepare these nanoparticles, together with a surfactant.
Yes,
and sir. Then you can separately disperse them in the fluid.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That is a more preferred method.
Definitely, I'll come back to you, sir, if anything is required.
Yes,
so
sir.
You have been given us a lot of support being here.
Yeah.
And I don't say like that, like you are also here to extend your support being in anywhere here, so thanks for your support, sir.
Yes, sir.
And sir would like to have one screenshot.
Yeah.
I request all participants, this is as per the instructions of AICT. I request all participants to just to switch on their videos once. Sir, Subramanian, sir, now you may take your one question and answer. We see. Sir, there was one question from is there any application of nanofluids in recycling field? It's a question from Godwin Barnabas.
Okay. You can actually, think of some applications, for example, if you want to, isolate this precious metals or, you want to isolate some of those rare earth metals and all that, some of those components can be extracted with the help of nanofluid.
Okay.
So because, the nanofluid itself can have some components which can have affinity towards these precious metals or, these kind of rare earth metals.
Yes,
so
sir.
You can actually do some kind of a refluxing or, you can do some extraction using the nanofluid. And then you can further, you can enrich it for getting the required precious metal or rare earth metal.
Very good, sir. That's a good answer by the professor. Professor Godwin, you might have got the answer. Still, if you guys, attendees, still, if you have any queries and all, you may please post on our group that can be conveyed to the professor and we would be getting back the answers. Right. And if you need any sort of support from the professor, we'll share professor's mail ID and contact also. You can collaborate in future with the professor if anyone is working on the same area. There were some questions, sir. There's one more question, sir. From Kaushik Nath.
Okay.
Is there any hazard associated with the disposal of used nanofluids?
Yeah, of course, with any nanosystems, there is some toxicology part associated with it, especially, if you are, but one of the things, you are using this nanoparticles in very low volume fraction. As I told you in the slides, you're using less than 1%.
Yes, sir.
So the hazard may not be too much. It may be very minimal.
That's good, sir. Kaushik, sir, you might have got the answer because we are using this, the volume fraction of these nano particles are being very small, would not cause most hazardous to things, right?
Yeah, right.
Thank you, sir. Then now I request all participants to just to switch on the videos, would like to have just a screenshot of the session. Sir Subramanian, sir, you may please take off your... PPT, sir.
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Yes,
sir. Only few participants we can see except the panelists. Attendees, you may please switch on the videos. No option for the video on or off. Let me check once. Oh, I'm sorry, like Shashank Bhushan, sir, Subramanian sir, there is one question from a participant.
Yeah.
Sir, what are the processes of synthesis of the ferrofluids, sir?
Yeah, so basically, you know, like I have just given a sample route, you know, where it involves, you know, like mixing of the chemicals and then, you know, precipitating the, you know, magnetic precipitate. And then, you know, you also add some acid and, you know, some nitrate. And then you you actually, you know, like you cause the refluxing and, you know, then you finally disperse it in an organic solvent. So I just given a profile of, you know, how to synthesize Fe3O4 nanoparticles in a cyclohexane.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Professor Shashank Bhushan, maybe you understood the answer professor has given. Thank you, sir. Now let's look for this. The attendees are facing some problem with enabling video.
Okay.
Let me check it on. This is okay. But we want a screenshot with the attendees. There was some technical issue with the on-off option of the videos for the attendees. Okay. Anyway, I've taken with the panelists. That's thank you very much. Okay. Attendees, there that option would be enabled in the future if there's some technical issues going on. I'm extremely sorry for that. And now I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to our Professor Subramanian sir for his patient presentation and sparing valuable time in spite of his busy schedule with the research activities. Thank you very much, sir, Subramanian sir. And it's a special thanks from Geetham University, Mechanical Department, Bangalore Management.
Yeah.
Heartfelt gratitudes to Subramanian sir. And we always look forward to have your participation like this in the forthcoming events also.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And this is a great opportunity for you to just look at you once. Yeah, it's been a long time being in the pandemic.
Yes, sir. I hope the pandemic gets over soon. So.
Sure, sir. Definitely. Let's hope. Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye, sir. Thank you.
Bye, sir.
See you, sir. Friends, I'll end up the meeting. That the feedback form would be posted on the group soon, right? I don't know, postally have I. Now I'll end up the meeting. Thank you, participant. Thank you all. Let's look forward to participate in the tomorrow's events also. I appreciate for the patience of the participants for being with us during the three active sessions presented by the eminent people. And we are very, very lucky and honored to have such a eminent people as a speakers for today's session. Thank you, one and all. Have a good day. Thank you.